Good morning. Well, we still have some eggs left in the back, so the hens are laying again. That's a good thing. So thank you, William and Sandra, for doing that. So for $4 a dozen, which is like a bargain. I mean, it really is, especially because you can't get any fresher than these ones, right? So, and I don't know whether I want to gloat about this or be horrified about this. I predicted back in January that we would have snow on the ground until spring. Tomorrow's the first day of spring. There's still snow on Rattlesnake, and there's still a little bit of snow in some of the parking lots. Wow, what a winter. What a winter. So, more t-shirts, sweatshirts, administrative assistants, because miracle worker is not an official job title. And never trust an atom. They make up everything. Our family must be God's favorite sitcom. And I had to read this. This is backwards on a t-shirt, okay, like mirror image. This is my selfie shirt. And we do have a couple patron saints by the name of George Carlin and John Lennon. And we are the only church on Barth Way in Richland, Washington that starts our services with the Doobie Brothers. So I know that for a fact. I do. And John said, life is what happens to you while you're busy making other plans. So, dang. Hate that. He's right. And George, what year did Jesus think it was? I don't know these things. I'm going to read just a real quick excerpt from this magazine that I have. And the only reason I'm doing this is, yeah, it's a little bit too close for some of us older veterans, because some of us have experienced something like this back in the 60s and 70s. But more importantly, how important it is that what we say to people can have an influence on them for their entire lives. So this was Lance Corporal Wright. He was had just been in 29 Palms, Marine Corps, and he was on his way for action in the Vietnam War. On his way, and he had to get on a plane to go get all of his stuff done. So, as he made his way down the aisle to an unassigned seat for the flight that would take him home for a brief visit, the 20-year-old Marine was met with cold stares and upturned noses from the civilian passengers. As he searched for a seat, he endured snide whispers and derogatory remarks being directed toward his military unit. Once the plane took off, Wright looked from left to right and back to front and realized there wasn't another passenger within 5 rows of him. His fellow passengers had gone out of their way to sit as far from the young Marine as possible. Early in the flight, a stewardess approached the Marine and asked if he'd like to follow her to the cockpit. The captain wanted to see him. After overhearing the comments from the passengers and watching them turn a cold shoulder, this gentleman was thought to himself, great, what now? And reluctantly made his way to the front of the airplane. When he entered the cockpit, the captain introduced himself and then invited the Marine to sit down in the open seat next to him. After a brief introduction, the captain went on to say how he'd heard how the passengers had responded to the Marine on the flight. He told the young Marine not to take the other passengers' actions personally or to let it get the best of him. The captain explained that he'd served in the military himself and that most people of the civilian population in military uniform was looked upon as the enemy. It was back then. They don't understand the loyalty, the code of honor of being a Marine. You made the choice to put on the uniform today, and sometimes you have to be prepared for the resistance to the war effort. It might seem like you're the only one directing the protests here, but it's really the uniform. During the flight, the captain offered additional words of encouragement and even some advice. When you get home, take time to work on your relationship with your significant other. Get yourself a hobby. Find a way to occupy your time with something you enjoy. Find yourself a nice car, maybe the car you've always wanted. Most important, be proud of yourself, and don't let people bother you with their comments. Make yourself a useful person. And he went on to say that all of those words stuck with him his entire life, just from that little act of kindness. So there you go. All right. Things that make you go, When you have robbed a man of everything, he is no longer in your power. He is free. When there is no middle class and the poor greatly exceed in number, trouble arises and the state soon comes to an end. Aristotle, 384 BC. So. The modern custom station derives its name from an old French term costume. Actually, it's costume. Yeah, it is costume. Equivalent to costume or habitual mode of dress. This label was used so frequently that it attached to any common practice or usage, whether involving clothing or not. One such common practice was that of collecting rents, dues, and taxes. Lords and rulers were careful to see that no one failed to pay customary charges. Hence, any levy exacted as a matter of course came to be known as a custom. Several centuries ago, European kings adopted the ancient practice of exacting a charge as a condition for permitting merchants to pass through certain cities on trade routes. In order to collect customary passage fees, the officers had to be employed. In order to function, they had to have regular stations. So by the time Columbus discovered America, the custom house was a familiar European institution. As the base of international travel broadened, it was natural to have officers check the luggage of tourists as well as assess taxes upon merchants' goods. In popular speech, the old word for a habitual tax was slurred into plural form, with the result that it is now customary for persons who cross national boundaries to go through customs. So that's where it actually came from. Interesting. And the modern image of Santa Claus, rosy-cheeked old man wearing a blush red suit, was popularized by American artist Hayden Sandbloom in advertisements for Coca-Cola in the 1930s. Coca-Cola hit upon this advertising campaign as a way to boost slumping sales during the winter months of the Great Depression. So, all advertising. All right, it's been 5 years since I've done anything about Will Rogers. If you ever know anything about Will Rogers, he's had quite a wit. Died in 1935 in a plane crash. One of the greatest political sages of this country. Never slap a man who's chewing tobacco. Never kick a cow chip on a hot day. There are two theories to arguing with women. Neither work. So. Never miss a good chance to shut up. All true. All true. Hey, Tracy, you have something to say?
Yes.
Okay. I'll bet it's about our expo.
Oh, my gosh.
When is our expo?
3 weeks, you guys. Can you believe
three
that?
3 weeks.
Holy criminies, 3 weeks. All right. So what I'm up here to talk to you about is your donations for the silent auction. Last year we raised over like $2,000 just with items that were donated by you folks, your generous and kind hearts. So we're taking more donations again. I dug this out. This is a Princess House crystal bowl. Now we won't be doing this every time, but I did this for the purpose of showing you how it's going to work. There are forms that you will fill out. It tells what the item is, what the value is, your name and your phone number. So if you will fill out the slip when you bring in your item, place it in the item and leave it with the item on the back counter in the back room. The forms will be on the back counter as well, not in the bowl. This bowl particularly, it comes in a box. So if you have a box that comes with your item, leave it with it, but do leave the slip with the item inside the box. If you have gift certificates, those are lovely. If you could create some sort of a gift basket, just don't wrap the basket in cellophane. So gift baskets are awesome. If you make homemade like soaps and lotions and potions and that kind of stuff and you'd like to donate that, go ahead, put it in a basket, just don't wrap it up in the cellophane. Books, paintings, statuary, knickknacks, power tools, oh yes, men's stuff. Bring men's stuff, they like that. And they will buy it. And they will spend good money on it.
We had a big set of waders last year, and on Saturday, nobody bid on them, and I said, well, they can't see what it is, so they took it out of the box, they sold the next day. So, yeah.
Hip waders for fishing? Yeah, fishing stuff, hunting stuff, you know, whatever. If it's used, make it be gently used, because if it's really well used, it's either going to go in the trash or be donated to the Goodwill, because we won't sell it. Because it won't sell. I mean, think about it. If you were buying something at a silent auction, so when you bring in your donations, think about, would I bid on this myself? Okay, and then, like I said, 3 weeks, so that only gives us, what, 2 Sundays?
I know.
So there are classes throughout the week in the evenings here in the church, so if you can't bring it and you remember in the middle of the week, just show up during the evening when we're having a class, so long as they're not in the back or you're quiet or whatever, but, you know, bring those items in. We're going to use them and sell them.
And I just had another thought, actually. I've not gotten this approved by anybody, so everybody might say, oh, Phil, you're full of it, but what if someone was to donate their time? Like maybe a teenager says, hey, I'll do gardening for an hour. Or some guy will say, yeah, I don't know, I'll change your oil in your car. I don't know. But
so something like that would be put on a gift certificate type thing.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Perfect.
So if anybody who wants to donate some time.
Darning socks, hey, I'll
maybe
darn
we could
socks.
Raffle off people for dates and lunches and stuff, right? You know?
Yeah, I don't know about that one.
If you know any restaurant owners. Okay, so there's
what
our first
would you do
one.
With all the money?
What are we
going to
do, like lunch date with Phil? So, yeah, you can contact your restaurant people that you know and see if they'll donate gift certificates,
yep.
You know,
right.
That kind of thing. Businesses yep. That you know. So, yeah. Anyway, any questions?
Cool. Brittany. Yeah. She wants to talk about, she's going to talk about the expo, too, for volunteers.
Oh, look, like Statue of Liberty.
Did you turn that off?
I did.
Okay, just hit it once on the bottom until it turns green.
Fancy. Huh? Good morning. So the expo is coming up in 3 weeks. We are doing wonderful with the volunteer slots. There are very few things that I need to fill, so I just figured I'd kind of mention that this morning. We need a little bit of help with the ticketing. The front desk or the front area when you walk in and you give them your tickets and the money and kind of greet people. So we've got a few slots open for that and a few slots open to help with the silent auction during the actual event. So if that is something that you are interested in doing or you know somebody who might be interested in doing, please reach out to me or Janice. Janice can forward them on to me. You're welcome to text or call me if I've already been in contact with you and it sounds like something you would like to do. Other than that, I am absolutely blown away at the response that we have had this year. It has been incredible to see how many people have volunteered their time. So thank you guys, because it would not, I am only doing the volunteer part. And I could not imagine what you guys, so many years you guys have done this successfully. And it's a lot, and it's not possible without you guys. So thank you very much. And if you guys have any questions, you can just give me a call or text or talk to me here.
Thank you. Yeah, 17 years, hard to say, hard to imagine, 17 years of doing this. Oh, one more? All right.
We have lots of flyers that we could use some help putting out, too. What works, like maybe 2-3 hours, visiting the small mom and pop type shops. And most of them are just really, really open to putting them in the window or on their door or something if you just ask them. So it's fun in teams. Like one person drives, one person jumps out. So if you got a buddy and you can...
Yeah, yeah okay. So long as the other person waits for
stop.
Them. Oh, yeah.
So, yeah. Yeah. So, yeah, a couple hours, you can put out a lot of flyers. And if you think about all the foot traffic in each one of those stores, it helps a lot. So contact her, and I have the flyers, or Janice has the flyers.
I'll get them to you. I took them back.
Okay.
And Sharon has been doing an amazing job of advertising, and especially stuff on Facebook, and you know, doing all that stuff. So I encourage anybody to
share.
If you don't know how to share, ask her, because sharing is like super important.
So. It really helps visibility.
The fattest knight at King Arthur's Round Table was Circumference. He acquired his size from too much pie. I thought I saw an eye doctor on the Aleutian Island, but it turned out to be an optical illusion. She was only a whiskey maker, but he loved her still. I know. And I am so going to probably get in trouble for this one, but, and there's no children, so anybody new, I'm sorry in advance, so, okay. A Baptist pastor was presenting a children's sermon. During the sermon, he asked the children if they knew what the resurrection was. Now, asking questions during children's sermons is crucial, but at the same time, asking children's questions in front of a congregation can be dangerous. So, having asked the children if they knew the meaning of the resurrection, a little boy raised his hand. The pastor called on him, and the little boy said, "Yeah, I know. If you have a resurrection that lasts for more than 4 hours, you're supposed to go call the doctor." Yeah, and it did say it took over 10 minutes for the congregation to settle down after that. So, yep. I barely got an eyebrow raised out of Jan. Okay. Oh. Alison Krauss, Down to the River to Pray. Old favorite. Okay.
Okay, one more thing. Well, I was sitting down and I looked over and I saw the quilt. You guys, isn't that beautifully amazing? Chris makes us one every year. And it's a good seller. We sell raffle tickets, $5 each. You will need to fill out your name and information on the back if you want to win and collect. Because if we can't contact you, then I'm just going to pull another name. How's that? And it might be mine, right? So $5 a ticket. You can see me after church. Almost Mother's Day would look lovely on someone's mother's bed, is what she said.
Daryl must be here.
God!
Yay!
Hello! Discombobulated?
No.
Evidence that I'm discombobulated. There's a reason for that. It's warmer up here. Oh. Let's adjust things just a tad. Thank you for your patience. So, speaking of discombobulated, it's been a weird week. You know, I had decided to get a booth at our expo. And then yesterday was like, what was I thinking? I can't do that. I just all messed up. My brain is not working. And then I realized that tomorrow is the anniversary of my mother's passing. And she passed away 7 years ago. So even though I miss my mom, and I'm not in that grieving stage where my heart's broken, my body remembered. And even though I wasn't conscious of the distress, it was still there. So grieving is this incredible process that the body does and the inner being does even when we're unaware. And the same thing is true for people who have PTSD. If you have an event, comes time of the year for an anniversary of that event, you're going to experience some of the same grieving kinds of things. There's a lot I want to share with you about that. Part of this is just a natural process that we get to just be aware of. Some of you are more active in that grieving process because the event was sooner. You know, it hasn't been very long since that event. So you're more active in that grieving process. Those of us who have been, it's been years since that shift or change or passing, we can still experience that because the body's memory will trigger a renewal of that grieving process. It's just a part of what happens. Now, the good news is it's normal and natural. The bad news with that is that if we're not careful, it can lead us down a really dark path. And the reason being is that, brain science here, sorry, I'm not sorry. I'm sorry, but I apologize, but I'm not sorry. When we think something over and over and over and over and over and over, even if it's an emotion, and we experience it over and over and over and over and over, the synaptic connections become hardwired. And the more we think it, the more we do it, the more we be it, the more we are it. And then if we have to think a new thought, then a new connector will arise and we'll shift and reconnect in a different way for a new feeling or a new thought. That's why you talk about having all that positive thinking. It's really, really important. It's not the only thing, but it is really, really important. Because if we can think positively, then we can shift the energy cycles. And if we're in a distress moment, if we allow ourselves to believe it, believe the truth of, I'm never going to be okay, I'm going to suffer forever, then that can get hardwired and be really hard for us to shift and move beyond it. And there's a lot of reasons for that. Because the heart is that powerful. And the heart is, it has its own truth. And sometimes the truth is not the truth. So if my heart is feeling discomfort and it says, you're just all screwed up, I can believe that, and then I stay stuck in that. And then guess what? The universe serves up stuff that proves it to me. Because after all, that's my belief system. So when we get into these moments when emotional things are physically manifesting themselves, it's really important to choose differently. So instead of falling into, I'm alone, nobody will ever love me again, or I'll never be loved the same way. Whatever our pattern of thought is, whatever comes up for us in those stressful moments, if we can take a look at them and just be aware of them. The Good Book talks about this. It has some interesting things to say. And it sounds, as I read this, you're going to go, well, that's contradictory. That's why I don't believe about it. Trust the process, please. Actually, I want to read three verses together. I love these. Love this. Blessed is the man who trusts in the Lord and whose trust is the Lord. For he will be like a tree who's planted by the water that extends its roots by a stream. And he will not fear when the heat comes, but its leaves will be green. And it will not be anxious in the year of drought, nor cease to yield fruit. Verse 9. This is Jeremiah 17, verse 9. The heart is more deceitful than all else. It is desperately sick. Who can understand it? Hold that thought. No judgment, just hold that thought. Proverbs 4:23. Watch over your heart with all diligence, for from it flows the springs of life. One more. A joyful heart is good medicine, but a broken spirit dries up the bones. So the heart, there's two different aspects of this heart thing. Well, there's three. Physical heart, you have heart, boom, 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 that's your heart. Then there's the emotional heart. That person said something, hurt my feelings, I can't like them anymore, I'm going to run away from home, you know, all of those things. I'm just going to quit that job, you know, the emotional response. And then there's the soul heart, or your heart of hearts, where your truth resides. Now, our feelings can sometimes feel like truth. This is how it is. Nobody loves me. Well, that's not true. That may be the truth that you're experiencing right now, but it's not the truth. That's the deceitful heart. So telling ourselves or amplifying a feeling then becomes locked and loaded, and that's where we live. I battled depression a lot of my life. And thinking negative thoughts about myself is a luxury I cannot afford. Not one. Phil and I laugh. Because if I start, if I actually verbalize, he'll say, stop it. Just stop it. It's not very kind. But sometimes you just need to be a give smack upside the head, right? You needed that. We must stop the madness. Because if we don't, it'll eat us alive. When we get locked and loaded into a depressive thought or a sad thought or a negative thought about ourselves, we spiral down because we get locked into that. And that's our first go-to spot. And it takes energy to back off from that and think a new thought, and then new connectors will arise. But when we get those new connectors locked in, then it's hard to go back to that. Now I look at people who are depressed and it breaks my heart. It's hard work to yank yourself out of that and make a new thought, but it's so worth it. Not one negative thought about yourself. Not one. It's a luxury you cannot afford. Can you afford a Porsche? Great, go buy one. You cannot afford a negative thought. The cost is too high. Because from the wellsprings of your heart flow your life. Your life force. And if your life force is not something that makes you planted like the tree planted by the stream, if it's not going to give you strong roots, back off from that. It's a luxury you cannot afford. I can't afford it. You think there's no cost to that? It's like eating bonbons for 3 weeks straight. You'll pay a price for that. Your blood sugar will be through the roof. Your energy will be through the floor. And there'll be a few pounds to pay for that. There's a price to pay. Pay the good price. Now here's the thing. Because we think that any unpleasant emotion is negative and we shouldn't have it. No, they're just unpleasant. They're normal, they're natural. Grief is a normal, natural process of life. We can't run from that. How we deal with that and what we think about ourselves about that, that's what I'm talking about. Because we can get locked into something that doesn't serve us, that steals our life from us. We have stuff to do. One kind word to a stranger changes their life. Phil read that this morning. One kind thought or expression to someone when they're needing it changes a life. And if we're sucked into, I'm no good, what are the chances we're going to talk to somebody? Zippity-doo-dah. You came to change the world, did you not? Absolutely. And we can't do that if we're locked down into thinking about ourselves as not good enough or not worthy. We all do stupid stuff. That doesn't make you unworthy. Doing stupid stuff over and over and over makes us do stupid stuff. But it doesn't make you unworthy. Shifting out of that, then the universe can serve you up something that will help you do better. When we think we're not good enough, the universe serves up stuff that proves that. When we think we're okay, when we think, hey, you know, I don't have all the answers, but, you know, I'm cooking along. I can be of service. The universe will serve that up to us. And if we think we're, like, awesome and we can really change the world, you know what? The universe will serve that up for us.
Yeah!
How about an amen?
Amen!
All right. Farta. Don't you just love this? Because when I woke up this morning, I was like, I have no idea what I'm going to say today. Phil, pray for me. Well, I always pray for you. Would you really pray for me today? Prayer works. Prayer works. Make sure you pray. So guard the heart of hearts. Protect that. And you protect that by by thinking things that are supportive and uplifting and loving of oneself. You can also sleep, get good sleep, eat right. Those are things. We expect our brain to do all this wonderful stuff for us, and then we feed it junk food. It can't function on that. We feed it junk food and junk thoughts, and then we wonder why we do stupid stuff. We do stupid stuff, but we're human. It's what are we going to do about it from here? How are we going to shift that? Okay, so you feel worthless. That's a feeling. That's not your heart truth. If you can figure out what your heart truth is, feed that. Feed that heart truth. Okay, I feel like I'm worthless right now. Do you know what? I'm really good at crochet. I could crochet really well. I can make a sock in a minute. You know, whatever. I don't know. What's your strong suit? You have one. Find it. Hang on to that and feed it. Feed it. Like the guy who does lawn stuff. Feed your lawn. Feed it. Feed it. Feed your mind. Feed your heart space. Feed your soul. Feed your soul the truth of who you are. Not the lie of who you think this feeling is expressing for you. Because your feeling is based on right now. What happens right now. And you know, stuff happens. Oh, my car broke down. And this happened and that happened. And it's just, I'm worthless. No, you're not. You're having a bad day. Remember that song, "'Cause You've Had a Bad Day"? So what? Shift that. You get to shift that. And it takes effort. It's easier to stay stuck in this old pattern of thought and just be there. What's an old pattern of thought that, not that you would have it, but what's an old pattern of thought that sometimes someone might get stuck in, do you think? It's too hard. It's too scary. I'm not good enough. I suck at this. I suck at this. I'm not worthy. Oh, heck, I did it again. Yes, Phil, what? It won't make a difference. Oh, yeah, we hear that one, don't we? That's a lie. It's a lie. It's a deception that your feelings heart is sending you. And who can understand that? Nobody can. It doesn't make any sense, but we do it anyway. Because we can. But we can also shift that because we can. And one way to shift that, the fastest way to shift that, is to move into a state of open curiosity. Look at that. There's a feeling. I just feel terrible. I don't know why. I just don't feel good. Just terrible. Well, look at that. It's just a feeling. But we give it so much power, it runs our life. No. Put our trust back in the Lord. Plant yourself by the stream of water of life, of love, being rooted and grounded in love. And you know what? That nourishes our soul. And that shifts things. It's hard work. It takes time. But you know what? The price for not doing it is too high. And the reward for shifting is phenomenal. Is absolutely phenomenal. So whatever you're feeling is just feeling. It's okay. It may be an unpleasant feeling. You know, I feel resentful of that person. No, that's okay. It's a feeling. Acknowledge it, notice it, and then move into a state of open curiosity. This state of open curiosity, it's better and easier if you can be in a state of open curiosity about something has nothing to relate to that. Totally shift gears. You've got to disengage, shift, and then reconnect in something else. So be openly, have open curiosity of, I wonder how many people are in church this morning? All over the world. Who? Your mind kind of goes, poof. It expands your awareness. I wonder how many churches meet at 10-ish. Okay, one. Wonder about something totally different. I wonder how many blue-eyed people there are in the world. I wonder how many brown-eyed people are out in the world. You know, wonder about something totally different that has nothing to do with what you're hung up about. Then choose a new emotion. Choose a new emotion. I feel like exasperated. Gee, I wonder how many candles are burning in the world right now. And now I'm going to choose to be joyful. Because here's the deal. We call them positive emotions. They're just not unpleasant. They're pleasant emotions. So they're desirable. So a desirable emotion. Pick one. You can pick anything. You can pick joy. You can pick bliss. You can pick enlightened, enlivened, excited, curious. You could pick driven. You can pick anything. What do you want? Not your heart, that's the emotional part of you, because your heart wants to feel icky. It doesn't want to deal with that. It wants to shut down and play video games. But your soul wants to have purpose. Your soul wants to live. So pick one. Have that open curiosity and pick one, and then do something that feeds that. I had a conversation with my brother earlier this week. We were talking about stuff. We were talking about soul retrieval. I said, "Do you know what about soul retrieval?" He says, "No, I hadn't really thought of it. Hadn't really heard of that." And we were talking about that, and he was like, "Okay, whatever." But I said, "You know, even when, you know, there's a special process that I can do, and I'd walk you through that." I said, "But you don't even have to have that process. If you get hung up about something, if you can find a time or a thing that you used to do before a traumatic event, if you find something else that you used to do and go do that, that takes your energy back to that moment of happiness and joy and brings it front and center, present time, present tense. Well, my entire childhood was a mess. Okay, maybe it was. But maybe somewhere in the last however many years of your life, you've had an opportunity where you were sitting on a mountaintop and sitting by a stream fishing. Or maybe you were skiing. Maybe whatever, you know? What is something that you loved that brought you great joy? Do it. And if you can't physically do it, do it. Your imagination is powerful. It's a power tool. Use your imagination, because what happens is that your brain goes, oh, I'm disconnecting from that, and I'm remembering this over here, and the memory is the same as experiencing it. And you know what else? If you have not experienced it and you imagine what it might be like to do that, it's the same as experiencing it. It will start hardwiring new neurotransmissions, new neural connections. You're rewiring your brain to what you want it to do. And that feeds your heart space, and your heart feeds that brain. And they interact, and you can move forward in joy and empowered. It's a choice. Every day is a choice. Every day is a choice. Every minute is a choice. Choose this day whom you will serve. Are you going to serve that old negative pattern of thought, old unpleasant pattern of thought? Are you going to shift? Pick a new way of thinking. Pick a new way of being. And you can. And hang in there. Depression is something that I struggled desperately with for many, 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 many years in a very hard, dark way. I can tell you now that I have an inkling of it and I can remember it. But it's so worth it to not be there. So worth it to not be there. And if you're there, it's okay. Because life happens. And sometimes life throws us a monkey wrench. But you know what? That monkey wrench is here to help you reinvent the wheel. You were thrown that monkey wrench for a reason. Because now you have a different tool to help somebody else who's on the same path. So trust the process. honor where you're at, and begin your journey. And your journey begins right now with a new thought. And your new thought can be as simple as, if she can do it, I can do it. Because from where I was, you wouldn't want to have been me. And I had no hope. Looking back to that, bless her soul. Bless her soul. And it was one tiny step at a time. And the first step is shifting how I think and how I feel about this moment and about myself. And it shifts with that divine connection. Because you know what? I had to pray for willingness. I didn't have the willingness. I was so full of despair that hope was not an option. There was no hope. And I had to pray for willingness to even reach for the hope. So maybe your first step is willingness to see it differently. Willingness to be curious about life. Willingness to look at it differently. The journey is worth it. The journey is mandatory. You came to change the world. Start with the man in the mirror. Start here. Tiny little bit. One step at a time. And so you've had a bad day. It's okay. Shake it off. Think a new thought. Feel a new feeling. Choose what you're going to feel. Well, I don't feel like joy. Choose joy. Joy will find you. When you choose a new feeling, it will find you. You will say, okay, I'm going to choose joy. And then all of a sudden, a bird will fly across your field of vision. And you go, oh, look at that. That was wonderful. Joy. Just happened. But when we're locked down, that same bird could fly by and we'd never notice. So make a new choice. Figure out what it is your heart desires and make a new choice from there. Let's do a guided meditation.